In my last video, I had discussed, we had learned right to religion, and as a continuation of that topic, a conspicuous issue which has been in news is Ayodhya issue, because Supreme Court has given the final verdict on this. So the dimensions are, first is, I mean, in terms of looking at the overall topic, there are many aspects related to it. There are historical aspects, so Ayodhya architecture, history of it, and archaeological survey of India, these are all cultural aspects. Other issues are polity aspects, wherein there could be judiciary, there could be parliamentary aspects, like places of worship is parliamentary aspect, constitutional aspect is there, judiciary rulings are there, certain judiciary related terms are there, those will be picking up. So in total, it will be a one-stop solution for all the issues of Ayodhya related to prelims. For a mains video, there is a separate video which I've done on Ayodhya that was catering to mains related issues. In this video, I'll be restricting myself to what could be possibly be asked in prelims with respect to Ayodhya. So first, hello everyone, welcome to Manifest IAS. You're watching Current Jots. This is Manjunath, Polity Faculty at Manifest. Current Jots is a current affairs initiative which we started on April 1st, and as part of this initiative, we'll be covering all significant current events that have transpired since June last year. We're not only providing free videos, but also free PDFs are available for download, the links for which are posted in description comment section. Also, the timestamping of these videos is given in the description. In this, we'll be looking at various dimensions related to it. Before knowing the dimensions, the most unique component of this initiative is strategy talk, wherein we'll be raising certain issues which might pester the minds of UPSC aspirants while preparation. So it's not just preparation, the method of preparation is very important. Keeping that in mind, these questions are raised and I'll be answering them at the end. And the question which I've raised here is the same question which I did in citizenship part one. I couldn't answer there due to a technical snag, so that I'll be answering in this particular video. Moving to the dimensions part now. Also, if you have any specific queries regarding your preparation, you can post those queries in the comment section, or you can write to me at manjunath.manifestis@gmail.com. Moving to the topic list.
Subscribe now and press the bell icon. Never miss an update.
First, we look at the historical aspects. Getting to know the history will be important in order to understand the basis of judgment and also what is happening today. So if you look at Ayodhya as a place, historical aspects you should be knowing, and also Babri Masjid, architectural values and architectural features of it you should be knowing. So in traditional history, Ayodhya was known for kingdom of Kosala, and though in Buddhist times, I mean, Ayodhya was the capital of Kosala, later on Shravasti becomes their capital. But during Buddhism, or age of Buddha, Buddhist times, which is popularly known as, during this period, Ayodhya gains prominence because of the predominance of Buddhist culture, particularly the monasteries. Chinese Buddhist monk Faxian in 5th century BC, he speaks about 100 monasteries existing in Ayodhya, but I mean, the number 100 may be just a way to describe the predominance of the monasteries. 100 might be an exaggeration, not really in terms of the number. So it could just be depicting the predominance of the structures or Buddhist culture there. Also, there were stupas during the same period, later on built during the Mauryan Empire, particularly under Ashoka. Now, what happens during the medieval period? Ayodhya's name gets changed to Awadh, and later on under British India, the same term is, or the same name gets used. So there in medieval kingdom, Kannauj kingdom becomes a prominent kingdom in Ayodhya. Later on, it comes under Jaunpur, Delhi Sultanate, and after that Mughal Empire. So these are the two major empires during medieval period. Under Delhi Sultanate, it was under a regional kingdom called Jaunpur Kingdom. As a result, when you know these kingdoms, you also see that the masjid is influenced with architectural styles, Tughlaqite style, Lodi style under the Delhi Sultanate. It is also influenced by the Jaunpur Kingdom. We look at the architectural styles later. Later on, it comes under British India, East India Company, and finally it gets annexed. It was under the influence of Talukdars. Finally, it gets annexed on the grounds of maladministration, which is part of the popular imagination, because it is on this grounds that British Indian governance gets heavily criticized. So finally, we'll come to the masjid. The mosque of, it is said that it is a mosque built in the orders of Babur, and it is built by his commander, that is Mir Baki. And under Babur, there were three mosques built simultaneously, mosque at Sambal and Panipat as well. So this is a 16th century mosque. 1528 is the exact year which has been attached to it. Now, what are the styles involved in this particular mosque? The styles involved are three. One is the Delhi Sultanate Tughlaq style, Lodi style, and also Jaunpur style. So these three styles, Tughlaqite style, what does it refer to? Tughlaqite style refers to, what is adopted from Tughlaq style, the environmental control system, the air cooling systems, the ventilation in the Babri Mosque is an influence of Tughlaqite style, is what it is said. Also, with respect to Jaunpur style, it resembles a masjid called Atala Masjid. Now in Jaunpur, what are the architectural elements it has borrowed from Jaunpur? Battering effect. The battering effect refers to the sloping walls. So if a wall is sloping, it is called battering effect. Arch beam combination refers to this part where there is a beam and also an arch beam combination. The facade of the mosque refers to the front part. The front part is it seems magnificent, and also when you say front part, there is a technical term for this called propylons. So propylons is the entrance. The entrance is lofty with sloping slides, which I've already discussed. And also there are tapering square sides, is what it says. So tapering square sides is this. So basically the facade of the front part is influenced by the Jaunpur school. And within the mosque, the environmental aspects and also the cooling systems are influenced from Tughlaqite. Now, what has been borrowed from Lodi style? The other architectural elements like double dome system here and chhatris. These are the small chhatris which you can see and which become a prominent architectural feature under Mughals as well. Then gardens are prominent. These are the prominent features of Lodi Kingdom. Octagonal tombs, this is the octagonal shape, and colonnade surroundings. Colonnade surroundings refers to the columns wherein you have large number of columns which encloses a space within it. So these are the features. So in total three: Tughlaqite, Jaunpur, that is the provincial local kingdom, and also third is Lodi features. Having understood the historical and also the architectural elements, we look at certain literature on Ayodhya, because literature on Ayodhya was particularly referred to in the judgment. There the Supreme Court was very clear that it said we are not giving our judgment on the basis of any kind of historical evidences. It is purely decided on as a civil case. But when they still refer to certain writers and travelogues, so those travelogues and writers become important. I've given the list of the name of the books they have written. I'll just point the name of the historians. You can refer it for yourself. Tiffin Taylor was one person who was referred to. Finch was another person. Montgomery was the other person. Three people were referred to, and I've given the books. Just have a look in case if they ask in prelims. Also, Babur Nama was referred to, Chronicles of Babur, and also you have Aini Akbari was referred, written by Abul Fazl, and Ramcharitmanas was also referred. So I've just given you a list of books which were referred in the judgment. Then, so possibly a question could arise in prelims. Next is, what was the verdict about and what does it say? The Supreme Court gave a ruling that the 2.77 acres of land, that is the disputed Ram Janmabhoomi, is now allotted to Hindus. And it also goes one step ahead and says that there should be a trust established, a scheme should be formulated by the government within 3 months, and a trust should be established to manage the property and also to construct the temple. Now, what is the decision given to the with respect to the Muslims? They will be getting an alternative 5-acre plot, which is at a suitable prominent place in Ayodhya itself, where they are at their liberty to construct a mosque. Mosque construction is not the duty of the state, maybe the central or the state government. Here, the mosque construction of a mosque depends on the Sunni waqf board, whether they want to do it or not. So, and it also says that it should be done simultaneously once the transfer of the property to the proposed trust. Hindus, it is done. At the same time, it should be done here as well. Now, this is the judgment given. Now, we have to understand, despite the Supreme Court saying that the Acts of 1934, Acts of 48, 34 is the first time when there is an evidence of right. They did occur even under British India, but 34, we have a clear evidence of riots with respect to Ayodhya. 34, 48 and also 1993, they were constituted as egregious violations, but yet Hindus were given the right or entitlement over the entire land. What was the reason for that? That we'll look into. The reason was, Supreme Court looked at the entire case as a civil case, and not it refrained itself from making any kind of political comments. It refrained itself from making any kind of refrained itself from looking at the entire issue as a political issue. So when it looked at as a civil case, now civil case and criminal case are two different cases which I'll be dealing at length when I discuss judiciary. The one basic difference between a civil and a criminal case is the standard of proof. In a criminal case, the standard of proof is slightly higher. That is called beyond reasonable doubt. Whereas in a civil case, the standard of proof is balance of probabilities. What is beyond reasonable doubt? There shouldn't be an iota of doubt that the burden on the prosecutor is to prove that without an iota of doubt, that he or she should prove that the person is either a criminal or not a criminal. So, whereas balance of probabilities is what? There are two parties and both the parties have certain arguments to lay a claim on the land. But one is having more claims and the other is having lesser claims. Whereas in a criminal process, it will be having, the other party will not be having any claim at all, any proof at all. So that is called beyond reasonable doubt. So standard of proof in civil cases is lesser in India. That is called balance of probabilities. The probabilities lie on which party. The scale tilts towards which party is what constitutes the balance of probability. So once the case is decided, it is called preponderance of probability. So the preponderance of probabilities was towards the Hindus. How was it done? How did it preponder towards the Hindus? This court says that there is a clear evidence that Hindus worshipped the outer courtyard prior to 1857. And Muslims also prayed there within the inner courtyard. But after 1857, note this point that is not mentioned, after 1857, it is Hindus who continued their uninterrupted worship, whereas Muslims stopped praying there. So the right or the claims of the Hindus are much stronger than a Muslim, than the Muslim community. Hence, the entire land is being given to them. But it also, when you look at the judgment, it seems to be tilted towards Hindus despite saying that those acts are egregious violations. So in a way, it could seem that it is somewhere legitimizing those egregious violations. So in order to tone that down or moderate it, so judgment also says certain other things which are important for prelims as well. First thing it says is land cannot be recognized as a deity. This was a demand made by one of the plaintiffs. There were three parties in this. Sunni Waqf Board was there, Nirmohi Akhada was there, and Ram Lalla was there. Ram Lalla demanded two things from the judgment. One is, it says that the land itself should be recognized as a deity. Second, Shibet rights, that is the worship right, should be given to that particular party. So both these were not accepted, and this issue is important because there is certain reasoning given. The Supreme Court says that land cannot itself be recognized as a deity because the method of worshipping cannot cause an advantage or disadvantage to a particular religious group. What do you understand by this? Muslims do not believe in any kind of worship, physical worshipping, whereas Hindus believe in certain forms of physical worship, where there is an idol, etc. So when you consider, so if you consider land as a deity, that will set a precedent. It will be more favorable towards Hindus just on the basis of method of worshipping. So it was not recognized. Land cannot be recognized as a deity, is what is said. Second is, if land is recognized as a deity in this case, Supreme Court says that there will be a series of cases lining up demanding ownership or entitlement over a particular land on religious issues and cultural issues. Third is, it says that if land is recognized on religious basis, in case that land is needed for welfare of the people, in case that land belongs to a particular private member or an individual, in that case what happens? State won't be having any right over that land in case it wants to acquire it for public welfare. It is not possible because religious right will be having more weightage over that if it is recognized under this. Third is, if land is recognized on the religious basis, if it belongs to any particular individual, all his rights will be extinguished in one stroke, is what the Supreme Court said. And finally, it also says that if you recognize land on religious basis, it alters the very nature of land and property and the discourse of land and property. Hence, it does not do so. So remember these points. I mean, if it is asked in prelims, I mean, on uncertain basis, if UPSC goes for a higher level of analytical questions with respect to this judgment, this question could also pop up. Third is, I said three acts, that is 34, 48 and 90. 34 refers to the riot in Ayodhya. 48 refers to when idols were surreptitiously installed in idols of Ram were surreptitiously installed in the mosque. 1992 refers to the Babri Masjid demolition, consequently the entire history after it, Bombay blast, etc. and all. So 1992 particularly refers to the act of Babri Masjid demolition. Also, there was a demand that the mosque should be declared illegal. This was not declared illegal. Supreme Court refrained from this. From all this, we get to know that Supreme Court was trying to maintain a balance in terms of judgment and also not to be excessively favorable to any particular party. And it says that this is very important. I mean, the fifth and sixth point are very important. Many parties today, there is a general feeling or there is a general discourse prevailing in the country today that many of the mosques or many of the temples were earlier razed down by Islamic rulers, then they built their own culture, but they were barbaric, etc. And such kind of a reading has actually brought communal tensions in the society. So in order to avoid that, or in order to give a solid proof for that, it says that there is no evidence of raising down the earlier structure. It says that there was a structure existing earlier, but there was no evidence to prove that the structure was actually pulled down by the ruler and then the mosque was built. This is, they, in order to support this argument, they give the report of ASI. Archaeological Survey of India says clearly that there is no evidence of pulling down the earlier structure. Second is, no evidence of using the material. Also, it says that earlier buildings material, kasauti pillars it refers to, these were not used, or there is no evidence to prove that it was used in the construction of the mosque. Also, it invokes Article 142 and 372. What are these? We look into. And finally, the Places of Worship Act. All these judgment, all these rulings which I'm talking about, they in a way try to preserve or attempt to preserve the idea of secularism, and also it tries to moderate the feeling of being tilted towards Hindus in some way. Next is molding of relief. What does molding of relief refer to? If you remember, even prior to the judgment, there was a mechanism to solve this dispute. A mediation method was followed. And in the mediation method, the Supreme Court very clearly said that if mediation efforts do not work, molding of relief is to be done. That is, every party will demand, or every party while filing a case will give us will give us an idea of what they want from the judgment. What is their demand? So why was this done? Supreme Court was trying, molding of relief as a term becomes important for prelims. Supreme Court was trying all attempt, or it was doing, making all attempts to find a consensual solution for this. And molding of relief in a way gives an idea to the Supreme Court also to address all the parties fairly. Next is use of articles 142 and 372. Article 142 was invoked in the judgment when the Supreme Court was talking about the trust and also the formulation of a scheme. Now, what does Article 142 refer to? Article 142 is jointly read with one more article called 129. 129 talks about court as a court of record, and 142 refers to the power of the Supreme Court to invoke or to pass certain orders. So 129 and 142 are related to contempt of court. They strengthen the powers of the Supreme Court related to contempt. What is it? Under this, under 142, Supreme Court gets the authority to make certain orders or pass certain orders, such decree and or other orders. Now, when you say orders or decree, this is the function of executive. So somewhere 142, it slightly violates or it breaches the SOP, separation of powers, but for a specific reason only. The reason is in order to do complete justice. So if there is a feeling, if Supreme Court is of the idea or is of the feeling that this particular judgment may face hurdles in its judgment, hurdles in its implementation, in that case it invokes Article 142. It has been invoked many times earlier also. It has been invoked particularly in PILs where it has to pass orders or direct the executive to take certain actions for the welfare of the people in general. And more importantly, it was invoked even in when Supreme Court passed orders to during COVID itself, where it said that it was adopting social distancing and also the court will stop working for a few days, and it invoked Limitation Act. I discussed this in COVID Part 3. So 142 was also invoked there. So 142 basically gives the authority to Supreme Court to act like an executive, but in a certain condition, when it, if it feels that it has to do certain complete justice. Now, this, when you invoke orders, what exactly it is doing? It is trying to implement the orders of Supreme Court. So in this sense, it strengthens the contempt powers of the Supreme Court. It in a way avoids contempt like situation. Now, moving to the Article 372, how was this invoked? Now, there was a demand from various Hindu groups, particularly the VHP, after the judgment, that there were talks, there was a flutter in the entire community, wherein in the entire group, that they are going to raise many such issues like this. That is, after the judgment, they will be raising certain issues related to different mosques, which have been allegedly built on an earlier Hindu like structure, Hindu architectural structures. So on that so in order to avoid such litigations, in order to put a closure to this case and also any kind of further litigations, Supreme Court invokes Article 372. It says that I'll come to Article 372 later. What was the judgment? Supreme Court says that the judgment which is given, in Ayodhya is to bring a closure. It is not going to entertain any such litigations further. Also, in the judgment itself, while ruling on this, it says that Places of Worship Act 1991 should be followed properly, and it has to be implemented in its true sense. It's a non-derogable act, or it's a non-derogable right given to the people. What is that? We'll discuss. So how did it invoke three? So then when it said that it's not going to entertain any such cases, the parties, that is the Hindu groups, asked Supreme Court, how did it, so when it is not entertaining or it does not have any authority to rule on historical aspects or historical events, How did it get the authority to rule on Ayodhya? It is then Supreme Court invokes Article 372. What is written under Article 372? Article 372 relates to all those pre-constitutional laws. What will happen to those laws which were passed or formulated under British India? So on that, Article 372 speaks of. It says that these pre-constitutional laws will continue to exist, and if any change is to be made, it will be made by a competent legislature. And also it gives the power to the president. The president may by order may make such adaptations or modifications within 3 years of the commencement of the constitution. So if it is within 3 years, it will be the president, or later on a competent legislature can do it. This was the arrangement made. Now in this, there is an idea called bequeathing. That is you are transferring certain laws from pre-independent India to the post-independent. Bequeathing also refers to transfer of power. So Supreme Court says that under British Indian laws, the British Indian laws were transferred from pre-independent state to the pro-independent state, and the authority to adjudicate on them was bequeathed to the Supreme Court. It was given to the Supreme Court. Now, so through this, it gets the authority to adjudicate on all those laws. Now, what is the law which was governing Ayodhya? In 1858, British India for the first time takes the entire land under its authority, and it is then in 1858 it exercises its sovereignty, because in 1858, if you remember, British becomes the sovereign authority, and after that, when it takes the it exercises its authority over the land, it divides that land into two and allowing Hindus to worship in the outer courtyard. So when Supreme Court or when British exercised its authority, it has also bequeathed the authority under Article 372. It is now transferred to Supreme Court, and Supreme Court gets the authority to adjudicate, is what it says. So this is the term pre-constitutionally bequeathed. It is given to Supreme Court. Through this, it answers, and it also invoked, it also refers to a specific act, that is the Places of Worship Act. Now, this act is important. What were they referring to in the act, and what was the history of the act we'll be looking into? Supreme Court said that it is not going to entertain any such related cases. Second thing it said is places of worship, because there is an egregious, it says that the egregious violation has happened by pulling down the mosque. It goes on to say that henceforth places of worship should not be converted, and Places of Worship Act 1991 should be strictly implemented. Now, what does this act say? This act was passed in 1991 under P.V. Narasimha Rao government as a response to demands made by VHP in 1990s. It was raising slogans regarding Babri Masjid, also regarding other mosques. It was mobilizing people on communal ideas. So Ganwapi Mosque was one. It was also laying a claim over Shahi Idgan Mathura. It also was saying that it was going to reclaim 3,000 mosques. So this was a dangerous situation then, hence the state had to act. As a result, this act was passed. What does this act say? The act says that the act freezes the status of all religious places from the date August 15, 1947. So in what state they have existed on August 15, 1947, they will continue to exist in the same state. No party has the authority, no party has the right to change it. In case of changing those religious places, they will be liable to be prosecuted. There is a punishment of 3 years and other further punishments as well. And it also gives a positive duty to the state. It says that state has a positive duty. When I say positive, what do I refer to? I think the point is not there, just note it down. So the positive duty refers to, it is the state should positively act in order to protect the religious characters of the places. And also the deadline you have to remember is August 15, 1947. Now certain things are there which are exceptions that do not come under the act. What are the exceptions? If any religious conversion has happened after August 15, 1947, those suits and appeals will not abate. But if the religious change or changes etc. have happened prior to August 15, 1947, those suits, appeals, they all abate is what the act says. But what are the exceptions? They will not abate if the conversion or change has happened after August 15, 1947. And what do not come under this? Monuments which are defined ancient monuments and archaeological sites defined under this particular act 1958, they do not come under that. It is only religious sites. And also, if any suit has been, so if a religious conversion has occurred after August 15, 1947, and then it has been, the judgment has already been given by the court, or it has been settled among the parties, they will not come under the act. Also, it makes an exception with respect to Ram Janmabhoomi, that Ayodhya should not be part of this. This was deliberately made because the case was pending in the judiciary, and the government felt that it could be solved through mediation or it could be solved through judiciary. So it was, the act was, or the issue was kept out of it. I told you, in case of violation of the act, 3 years punishment is, they are liable for 3 years punishment. Now this is the entire judgment. Also, to sum up the overall thing, when it was giving the judgment, it also overruled the judgment of Allahabad court. Allahabad had given a tripartite division. It had divided the land into three pieces, and then it had given to three different parties. Supreme Court overruled the judgment, said that it defied logic. That is the first word it says. Second word it uses is, it says that the parties did not demand this kind of a division. Despite the parties not demanding it, this kind of a judgment is made. Hence, it defied logic. Hence, it is incorrect is what it said, and it then gives its own judgment. So, this is the overall judgment, articles invoked, logic behind it, and also different features of the judgment. Now, finally, as a consequence of the judgment given, the central government has recently announced that not only 2.77 acres, the entire land, around 60 acres of the land, will be going to the trust. Then the trust will build not only the temple and all other facilities required for the structure, the temple. So following that, it says that a 15-member trust will be established. So when you say trust in India is governed by an act called Indian Trust Act 1882. Just for your knowledge, I'm giving it. I mean, you need to notice the difference between a trust, a society, or a company. Because there is a Companies Act 2003, Societies Registration Act 1860. Trust is under Indian Trust 1882. All trusts are governed under this act. So it could be a private or a government trust. So there will be a trust established, a 15-member trust. It will be named Sri Ram Janmabhoomi Tirth Kshetra. And composition will be 15 members, in which 9 members will be permanent, 6 will be nominated members. Also, while it was establishing the trust, it also gives 9 rules for its functioning. It says that the permanent office will be determined by the trust, where do they want it, and they will be free to take every decision related to the temple. But along with freedom given to them, there are certain rules also made. It also goes on to say that it's not just temple, also other facilities like kitchen, gaushala, etc. can also be built according to the decision taken by the trust. And the trust can legally accept donations from anybody. It could be individual, it could be NGO, they can also raise debt as well. But they do not have certain rights. And before, what are those rights which they do not have? They cannot sell the immovable property, they cannot divert the money which has been donated for the temple to any other purpose. And they will maintain a balance sheet and it will be audited as well. So in order to maintain a transparency, and also there will be no provision for salary in case they incur any kind of expenses, that will be paid by the trust. And the meetings will be headed by a president, and the president will be appointed with people. There will also be a general secretary. The president will be appointed by the members there. And there will be a general secretary and also the treasurer. So these are the provisions. This is the story till date, starting from 1528, wherein the mosque was constructed later on, 1934, 1948, 1993, and till date after the judgment, and then the recent notification by the government to establish the trust. Finally, coming to the other dimension, that is cultural aspect. I raised the cultural issues at the very outset, wherein I had discussed historical aspects related to Ayodhya and architectural features of Ayodhya. In this, in the entire judgment, a governmental body which played a key role in giving certain evidences. If you remember, I had mentioned that Supreme Court very clearly says that the mosque was built on an And there existed an earlier structure, but that earlier structure was raised down. There is no evidence of it. And it also says that material, there is no evidence to prove that the earlier material of the earlier structure was used. So where did this get the authority, or how does it substantiate its argument? It says that ASI does not give any evidence to it. ASI has clearly has given no proof for such ideas or such argument. So what is ASI, you should be knowing. This will be separately in detail dealt again in culture. I'll give you a brief idea of what exactly it is. It is a body, an attached office under Ministry of Culture, and it was established in 1861. If you look at the historical aspects, as of it, I mean, it is actually a successor of Asiatic Society of India, but in its present, in its current form, it was established in 1861 by Alexander Cunningham. And its headquarters is in New Delhi with 24 regional circles and 5 regional directorates. Why do you need 24 regional circles, etc.? To preserve the monuments, to preserve the local cultures, to preserve the regional cultures. Now, what are its major functions? Its major functions are conservation, preservation, and also environmental development of all the protected monuments. So what is a protected monument, how it is declared, that we'll discuss. And it also is responsible for preserving World Heritage Monuments and Antiquities. More importantly, the associated structures like maintenance of gardens, new gardens surrounding these monuments also comes under their authority. More importantly, they are involved in exploration and excavation of ancient sites. Through this, they will be articulating various phases of Indian architecture. Now, this is the function which was relevant to Ayodhya judgment, because they explored, they excavated the ancient site, then they brought the evidences, and also maintenance of archaeological site museums. So any kind of heritage items which are placed, which are put in the museums, etc., all those museums come under this, and there are specific acts related to that. We'll look at the act. So Antiquities and Art Treasures, there is an act. So this is the nodal body for that act. Now, what does this act, what does this act deal with? That we'll be looking into. All other than this, it also has research and training functions and archaeological related activities. Now, which are the two acts which form the governing framework for it? One is archaeological ancient monuments and archaeological sites and Remains Act, Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1958. This was in news recently, because under this act, it is clearly said that within 100 meters of the monument, no construction is permitted. Now, this is being relaxed. It is the 100 meter is now being relaxed. Now, construction activities are being permitted. This was heavily criticized, that it goes against the fundamental principles of protecting the monument, particularly under Article 49. Where there is a clear, and in DPSP, the protection of monuments is one of the fundamental functions of the state. So archaeological sites or ancient monument, we'll know the definition. What is an ancient monument? I mean, it could be any structure. It could be a rock sculpture, inscription, monolith, etc. But the key condition is it should have been in existence for not less than 100 years. So this is a possible question in prelims. So that then becomes an ancient monument. And how is an ancient monument declared? The ancient monument, before being called a protected monument, a 2 months notice is given in case anybody has any objections. Once objections are raised, they will scrutinize and then they'll take the final decision. So this is the process to declare a protected monument. So once a protected monument, it comes under ASI. And why this idea is also important, because these monuments do not come under religious places or the places of worship act. That was the exception as well. So I'm just making a link with that particular act as well. Also, recently there was one more news related to architectural sites. There is a National Mission on Monuments and Antiquities. This was launched in 2007. This was in news because many antiquities or many heritage items of India were stolen, and there is a nexus of criminals related to this, and there was a question also in related to this in 2018 in 2018 means how do you protect, or what is the importance of protecting architectural heritage was the question. So in context of this particular mission also becomes important. What does it aim to do? It aims to set up a base, a national register database for built heritage sites and antiquities. And it is also setting up at the state level as well. So this provides you a inventory of all the heritage sites. It provides an inventory of antiquities so that they are well protected. With this, we have done all the topics related to right to religion and also Ayodhya issue. Now, how is Ayodhya issue related to right to religion? It comes under the principle of secularism. So what you have to do is those judgments which I have given, that is the rulings which I have given, the list of rulings that land is not recognized, etc., those are all principles of secularism. So in India, secularism is a basic feature. It was declared in 1994. So try relating them to those try relating the rulings which I have given to the idea of secularism, which I have discussed in my earlier video, what exactly is the idea of secularism in India. Now, coming to the penultimate part of this, questions related to these the topic, wherein I have asked questions ranging from polity to history as well. So the first question is related to the cultural aspect, architecture, 372 related to polity. Third question is related to the statutory aspects of it, that is the Places of Worship Act, which I associated with even the Antiquities Act, as Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1958. So coming to the final aspect, that is the strategy talk, in which I have raised the issue related to current affairs, wherein I have asked, are there any correct and wrong methods of studying current affairs. Now, current affairs is one, I wouldn't call it a subject because it's not a subject, it's one section wherein it's dread, highly dreading to UPSC aspirants because of many reasons. One is many have understood the idea of current affairs incorrectly. Second is UPSC has, when you say current, it is not restricting to the current of, it is no longer current, it is not restricting to the events preceding the year of exam. It is going to very regressive questions of from 1990s, questions related to, once the regime has changed from 2014 onwards. This has made it difficult. Third thing is huge and massive flooding of material related to current affairs in the market, wherein almost each and every institution has its own version or compilation to study. So this has made it slightly difficult. So in that case, what exactly is the solution and how do you study? So what are the sources and all that I'll be talking about later, but more importantly, there are certain wrong things which are generally come, there are certain mistakes which are committed. First is, current affairs is not an independent discipline. When I say this, what do I understand by this? It is not like it is polity as a subject, it is economy as a subject, it is part of some or the other subject. What does it mean? Every subject has a current aspect of its own. So it is foolishness to study current affairs in terms of days. When I say in terms of days, it means on 22nd of March, what happened on April 3rd, what happened. This is the day wise studying of current affairs, and usually compilations are in this fashion also, wherein day to day compilations are done. So when day to day compilations are done, when you study it, it becomes difficult for many reasons. One thing, the first reason is it is very difficult to remember things which are independent and discrete in nature. It is very easy to remember things which are associated with your theme. So what do you understand by this? Instead of reading things on a day wise or day basis, read it according to the themes. What do you understand by this? Suppose there is an event. Coronavirus itself is an event. Where do you place coronavirus? It is placed under science and tech, or it is placed under polity. Under that, there is a section called health. Under health, there is a section called science aspects of health, under which there are diseases. One disease is corona. So if you link it this way, and whatever note making or whatever compilation you're doing, if you add it to your static part, so because diseases you might have studied in a static part as part of S&T, in that case what happens, everything related to health will be at one place. It will be easy to study, it will be easy to remember, it will be easy to reproduce. And this is, it has other advantages also. The other advantage is you may somehow scrape through in prelims with this kind of a method, wherein you read it according to days, wherein discrete memory is required, but it is very difficult in mains, because in mains you have to write a complete answer and you need all your thoughts, all themes at one place to write an answer, because it is thematically asked. They will be asking you What are the governance related issues in health? So in that case, when you have collected all governance related issues, maybe static or current at one place, you'll be able to write a beautiful answer. Otherwise, your points will be haphazard in your notes. Naturally, points will be haphazard in your brain. Your answer won't be coherent in the exam. So don't mistake current affairs for a subject. It is part of every subject. So do it thematically. So whatever we do at Manifest is also thematic based. Manifest 11, which we do current affairs weekly, it is thematic based. Now the videos which I am doing is all theme based, wherein we are not doing it on a day basis like March as 1 month or April and 1 month. We are taking up all issues at one place. Health, entire health, which have most significant events which have happened, have been covered as part of your 6 videos. So once you do this, it will be very easier to remember, because all are at one place, all are associated with one another, and it is compatible with your memory as well, because your memory works through association. So this is a better method of studying. And as far as sources are concerned, I would suggest you, whatever sources you have been reading all through the year, stick to it. There is no need for changing it suddenly, because you have very less time for prelims. Second thing is, do not at any point of time compromise with newspapers. Newspaper cannot be at any point of time substituted by anybody. Also, we have taken extreme care to include almost all current issues from newspapers, directly lifted from newspapers. It is not a secondary work. It is primarily sourced from newspapers. So 90 videos in total, watch them. It will suffice for all the events related to that particular year. Thank you. Have a great day.